I would try and specifically focus on issues of class, caste, gender inequities, which usually do not find any space in discussions around water, land, specifically water. So although there is a very clear sort of recognition that when we say or when we talk of equity, equity is not simply social groups, but the, in fact what was already touched upon was intersectoral locations, from the sort of interstate to transboundary issues. All of these contestations in a sense are questions of equity. I think the whole idea of equity, or even the way the term is used, equity or equality, there's a very common sense understanding that we have around some of these issues. Equality is, I think we've been hearing about it in the Constitution, that equality of equal opportunities, equality of rights. So it's very much within the realm of the broader goal, or something which we hope to aspire, that we really want to reach there, that that is where, you know, all of us as individuals, coming from different locations, coming from different social groups, whether advantaged, disadvantaged, that's one goal that we all aspire to, and it's really enshrined in a sense in our Constitution. So various references to equality that you see within the Constitution, and it's one of the agendas, as Joy said, that movements had articulated as one of the most sort of radical agendas and something that we, you know, really need to take forward. So that is really a goal there. It's something that we want to reach. Although that is so, equity really, how does equity then come into the picture? I mean, do we, does it mean that we sort of abandon the agenda of equality? Or does it mean that to even reach that, like we were having a lot of animated discussions within our free water supply group where, you know, do you just sit back and wait till that ideal state is reached? Or do you also have a plan of transition? Do you also have something that you have in mind in terms of, okay, if we have to reach there, are we thinking of steps to make a transition towards that, given the kind of context that we are in today? So that is, in fact, what broadly I think we can all understand equity as. Again, it's such a relative concept. Each one has been sort of understanding equity in their own context, developing solutions around equity as they play out in their own context. So broadly what we can see is that it's much more to provide a basis for what is really possible. But given the fact that we already are, for example, in an Indian context, such a diverse kind of a society where you're stratified based on your class, caste, gender, ethnic groups, religious groups. So there is a huge amount of diversity, which is again also linked to where you are located, for example. So if you belong to a Dalit group or a Dalit caste, you know very well that within a village where you would be located. So locations are not sort of isolated from what social group or social community you come from. So given all these constraints and given the kind of society that we are in, we still aspire that there should be a proportional benefit that should accrue to each of these groups. That's what equity effectively means, that there has to be fairness, that there has to be a sense of social justice, that we want a larger number of people to benefit from the different assets, whether it's assets or whether it is any benefits of the schemes or it's a poverty alleviation program that you're talking about. How really are these developmental goods, if we may say so, really distributed across different groups of people? So they definitely are not equal, but within a given context, there is some sense of justice in terms of their distribution. So it could very well change. So what we need to understand that equity cannot simply be a fixed notion. I think that's the first sort of meaning that we need to be clear about in the context of equity, that it very well changes. It will change not simply in a given geographical context, but it's so dynamic that it can change in the same geographical context. The way you understand and look at equity today could very well be different when, say, macro policies or macro reforms come in a very different way, simply. Or if there are shifts in people moving out of one area to another. And basically to say that it's a dynamic concept, and therefore the questions that remain for us later, which I think we should debate around, is whether equity can be legislated. And if we do legislate equity, if we bring it in the purview of law, what really are the implications of doing so? So that's something that we need to keep in mind, especially also in the context of water that we are looking at. So India being, I mean, I don't know if we can still call it a socialist state, but with a lot of socialist agenda, equality was very central to its debate. So we have several of these articles that pertain to equality. It's equality before the law, prohibition of discrimination on grounds of religion, race, caste, sex, or place of birth, equality of opportunity in matters of public employment. So we have an abolition of untouchability. So all of these are very much enshrined in our constitution and basically aimed at, as I said, the policies. I mean, this is the larger constitutional clauses that we have. But policies that are aimed at equity largely move in the realm of poverty alleviation, land reform, programs like NAREGA, for example, employment generation, would very much try and address this whole question of social justice and equity. Now we'll try to look at this whole question of class, caste, and gender. I mean, I'm sure all of you have a say on that, right? I mean, it's so much part of our common sense understanding that we all have an opinion based on our well-internalized beliefs around each of these stratifications. So I remember in school we always, I mean, later on, I used to be very proud of that, you know, we never discuss caste in our school. We don't know the, you know, but only later that we realize that how in our subconscious we, in fact, as it is, we assume that all of us were, you know, because we did, actually, we were all belonging to the privileged caste, and that's why we were in a particular school. So we never really had issues of exploitation or caste differences that really got discussed. So it's really so much part of what we take for granted. And there are very clear assumptions around what we understand of caste, what we understand of expectations of gender. So there's a very clear system that is actually part, an internalized part of ourselves, which we often do not want to really invoke, challenge, talk about. And therefore, much of that is kept, you know, that's not something that really impacts our, if we have to talk about the water sector, for example, how does it matter? That's, you know, outside the state realm, outside policy making. That's a baggage that you have, which needs to be sorted out in the social context that you are in, but it's not something you bring in lawmaking processes. So it's so firmly really entrenched in our belief systems, and it's interesting to see how, you know, creation of patriarchy, for example, or even theories around caste formations, how there was a very concerted effort made through various institutions. So how does this actually get perpetuated, right? I mean, why in the first place? These are questions that we don't really ask ourselves, but is it really a static situation that we are in? Was it always so that men dominated and women were subordinated? Was it always so that Brahmins were the upper caste? Or was there anything, was the scenario any different at any point in time in history? That's a question that we rarely ask, right? Unless we are students of sociology. Unfortunately, even students of sociology never did Ambedkar until very recently. But these are questions that we often don't think are really important, right? I mean, we would like to just take it as a given. And that is what actually continues with us throughout our entire process of thinking, knowledge building, discourse creation, as well as how we actually act at the ground level. So it is this that actually needs to be brought into the fore in terms of how historical disadvantages are playing out in each of the sectors that we would be talking about. And how every institution, so what happens? For example, if we were to just look at caste and why hierarchies got form. There's a very classic explanation that, you know, it's just the differences in occupation. It's not really a hierarchy. When every time you raise this question about reservations and the mandal agitations, one of the classic things is, why are we, you know, even bothered about caste? It's simply an occupation, differences in occupation. One group works on this, one group works on, that's the other occupation. So that's the way sort of it's become part of our sort of belief system. But what we do not really understand, that if it was simply differences in occupations, why would it be that penalties for certain castes were so strong and the benefits for certain castes were so high, if it was as simple as segregation of occupations? You definitely see privileges for certain caste groups, and you definitely see very high penalty levels for the so-called lower caste groups. So obviously there is a history. And why has this system perpetuated for so long a period? That's also something that we really need to start thinking about. I just want to spend a few minutes on this, because unless we have a bearing of why certain systems continue the way they do, no matter what kind of policy shifts and legal changes we bring in this context we are talking about water, this is a baggage that is never really going to be offloaded. Because it really doesn't matter if you have 33% reservation for women in the water committees, simply because that 33% is never going to come to the front to participate, because there is no discussion on the baggage that we are talking about. I mean, the very simple thing is that I have so much work to do, I have my children to care for, there's this nurture role that I have, so how do I get out of that to even participate in that meeting that I now duly, by a legal process, I am entitled to? So it's very important to understand how different institutions have played a very critical role in actually perpetuating these inequities and in actually maintaining this order. So nobody really, the privileged often don't want to change the status quo, right? I mean, why would you want to? I mean, this is something that you struggled for, fought for, whether through an ideological battle or whether through coercion. These were the two broad methods that we see in terms of caste formation as well as patriarchy. That if ideology and knowledge didn't work, then you always had a backup of violence and coercion. So you have so many stories, and Eklavya's story is so famous. I mean, we all know the story of Eklavya, where Dronacharya just asked him to cut off his finger as part of his thumb as part of the Guru Dakshina, right? He was the biggest competitor to Arjun, and Eklavya belonged to the lower caste. So it didn't work when Dronacharya said, I want a Guru Dakshina, and the only Guru Dakshina that he asked for was through a method of coercion and violence. So this is, history is replete with these kind of examples of how this dual kind of a mechanism has been used to actually maintain the status quo, to perpetuate it, and in fact to aggravate it in different ways. So you have institutions, like what? I mean, what are the institutions that you can think of which are part of our life and which we are in continuous contact with in our everyday lives? I mean, what I'm trying to say is that the Indian kind of patriarchy would be very different. Again, patriarchy is not a monolith that we're talking about. You know, there are patriarchies, actually. In the Indian context, patriarchy would have a very strong caste element to it, because you belong to a particular caste and you are a woman, so the kind of exploitation and subordination would be very much different. In fact, in Ambedkar's own writings, he says women are the gateways, because the entire caste system is a bounded system, right? I mean, you have to maintain that purity. So no intercaste marriages are permitted. And that's the one significant way, endogamy is the one significant way in which caste purity is actually maintained. So you have the entire Manushastra, which, you know, deals with how this needs to be maintained and what happens if there are intercaste marriages. So there's a separate law which actually discusses what happens to those marriages and offsprings of those marriages, how do you deal with it in this entire caste system. So women are considered as the gateways to the caste system, and this is the strongest argument that Ambedkar has put up, and much of literature around caste, in fact, unfortunately, doesn't talk about how patriarchy needs to be seen in the context of caste and how, in fact, it sort of perpetuates the caste system in India. So that is, but patriarchies across the world will change. Indigenous systems would have a different, indigenous groups would have a different kind of a patriarchy, and so would countries which would be the Western or other sort of models. So there are various institutions, right? I mean, you have family, you have marriage, you have markets, you have the state as the biggest institution. So all of these institutions are playing a very strong role in our lives without us really recognizing that role in a very significant way. It's so much part of our life that we don't want to critically engage with these institutions. For example, how does family make a difference to a woman and a man? I mean, so there are certain very well laid out norms and rules, right? I mean, we grow with it. We are so conditioned with it. The way we dress, the toys we play with, all of that is so much part of us that we don't really understand that this is actually guiding us in the way we sort of behave, in the way the choices that we make. And all of this extends to most of our work as well. So when I will reflect on the water sector as to how all of this is actually playing out on water or land, we'll be surprised to see how, in fact, all of these policies and legislations are also instruments that have unfortunately only led to strengthening of these stereotypes. So they have not really moved beyond the challenging. So there has been no challenging that you see of the stereotypes. So what we need to again understand here is that unless we start thinking and sort of introspecting on some of these institutions that are playing a very critical role on our understanding of social groups and the ability to leverage anything in society as being part of this social group, is something that will impact a wide array of things.